Okay, hi everybody. My name is Stefan Hovnanian. I run a web series called Website, where we try and help small businesses and solopreneurs and people like that create a smarter, better, smarter web presence. And today, I am joined with by Peg Fitzpatrick. Oh, I have such a hard time saying your name, Peg. I just call her the queen of everything. So
you can hashtag that.
I hashtagged it too. Peg's totally amazing. Met her on Google Plus, but I'd kind of seen her around, on Twitter and I think, probably just Twitter. But you know, she has introduced me to really the power of Pinterest to go along with Google Plus. And you know, being a guy and playing out the whole stereotype, Pinterest really wasn't my thing. Peg kind of introduced me to some really amazing synergies that the two of them have. So I'm going to kind of put her on the spot and let her talk a lot more than I, because she's definitely more of an expert about this. But I think what we'll do right now is Peg, why don't you say hello, introduce yourself to everybody, and like they need to know anything, you know, about you anyway.
That's the second time someone's done that in a hangout. Like, I'm sure there's people who don't know me. Hi, my name is Peg Fitzpatrick. I have a hard time with Stefan's name too. So, you know, we're always online. We're never talking to each other. It's okay. So I love Google Plus and I love Pinterest, but I am on pretty much every social media platform that there is, except Tumblr. Sorry, Tumblr people, I don't go on Tumblr. Because I love Pinterest, I never went there. I just said I'm not even going to go look at it because I loved Pinterest. So I chose Pinterest. I think I chose well. I don't know. But anyway, I chose that, and there I am. So what I do is I'm a writer. I'm a social media professional. So I do this for a job as well as because I love it. I love it, and it's my job. So I get paid for my job. It all works out. Yes, I get paid to pin. So there. That's another... So take that, people who think you can't do things. So it is part of your social media package. Let's put it that way. A lot of people thought it was just pictures and pinning, but it's really a marketing tool, and it can be it can just boost everything else that you do. And the reason that I love Pinterest is it has the longest life of any social media platform. Anywhere that you go, every post that you do, Google Plus, you can have an amazing post. You post two other things, it's essentially kind of gone. Sure, it has hashtags. Sure, you can search things really easily on Google Plus, but they are buried. Pinterest, you can make little boards. You can name them. You can have themes, and you can put things in there. Like, I have All Things Pinterest, where I put a link to this event that we had today. I made a pretty good graphic for it. One thing I love about Pinterest and Google Plus together is that you make one really good image, and the sizes are perfect together. So for me, that's amazing. Facebook is square. Facebook is the only one that's square. So I do an extra one for Facebook. I know that's kind of an extra step, but I do. So you make one really good graphic, you can pin it, and you can put it on Google Plus. And it's like double the money.
it's true. And I've gotten clued into a couple of, like, it's funny, I'm in the web business for a living, but when it comes to this type of thing, I tend to write a little bit more than I do on the graphic side of things. So I found, for me, it's brand new and one of the coolest things in the world, but, you know, people like you, Peg, have probably seen this a gazillion times, but sites like Pinstamatic, for example, where you can bring one of your images or just create like a little, you know, square JPEG that has text on top of it. It's like super easy. Nice little add-on.
I love Pinstamatic. I use that to do little quotes. I had a great idea that I found from my friend Aliza Litt. She's at Donna Karen on Twitter. She's amazing. Right now it's Fashion Week, so she's like literally blowing up Twitter. She trends, like personally trends on Twitter all the time because she's like a total powerhouse. And her thing is PR. That's what she does. She made Pinstamatic little quotes of nice things that people said about her. I was like, well, that was really awesome. Another thing that gets lost in the world, someone sends you a great quote, like a great tweet saying, Stefan, that your website, you know, the website that you just did for me, like, totally changed my business. That's awesome. Right. That's a tweet. It's gone in like 20 minutes.
Yeah, and not only that, you put it onto an image, you put it up And then you can link that to, gosh, you can, you know, I don't know if everybody, this is, you know, I tend to geek out on a lot of these things. So, like, one of the, and I'm sure some people who are more veteran pinners watching this are probably going to, you know, say, well, yeah, duh. But you can edit the URL that you're pinning to. And, you know, I know, like, for my Google Plus posts, like, quick example, I wrote one, these embedded posts came out the other day. And, you know, Twitter has, you can embed tweets and you can embed pins and you can embed Facebook posts now. So Google Plus said, hey, let's do the same thing. Wonderful. But so I created this little, I don't know, cheat sheet of a couple ideas that people could use for with their embedded posts. And but I did it on purpose, all in text. No, you know, big image like you would normally post on Google Plus to get a lot of attention. I figured this would be the type of post that gets embedded into people's articles that are writing about embedded posts. And I don't want an image in there because it kind of takes away from the text, right? So the idea was to write all the text, but now I want to put this on Pinterest. It's a nice little nugget of, you know, a great Google Plus post. And this is kind of where I did this 2 days ago, but something similar sparked the idea of Peg and I kind of connecting and talking about this. Mm-hmm. I created this little thing on Pinstamatic just to say creative uses for embedded posts on Google Plus. And when you pin from Pinstamatic, it, you know, takes you back to Pinstamatic. So what I did was I updated the URL to go back to my Google Plus post. So now mm-hmm. I have a Google Plus post without an image, but on Pinterest, you know.
Right. And people who are listening to this awesome tip, when you do it, you click on the little pin that looks like a little pencil, and that's the edit up in the top right-hand corner, and you want to do that on every pin to add the website that you want it to go to. Otherwise, yes, Pinstamatic does go to Pinstamatic, but you want it to go to your own website. So that's definitely one of the things I think people miss, that there's two chances to put the website on for every single pin. You can put it in the description. You always want to add your own unique description on Pinterest and put the link in your description, and then edit after you save it, edit, and then go back and put the URL in. It's very important. People miss that step a lot. And you know what? I find that if I find little tricks like that, everybody doesn't do the same thing, so that's why don't ever feel like you're sharing something that everything knows, because what I found is everybody does things like a little different in their own way, which is why I love talking to other people like you and other people in our groups, because you can always pick up awesome tips from other people. That's what I love about social media, and that's where Google Plus really shines, is the opportunity to share these ideas, where Pinterest is quieter and you're a little bit more by yourself there, which is fine for me at the end of the day after, you know, being on Google Plus and Twitter or wherever else. It's great to have a different thing to do there, but working them together, just, it helps everything.
Well, and there's another, you know, we're talking about Pinstamatic, but the reality is this, if you have pictures that you use yourself, you know, whether they, I mean, and this could be for anything, even if you have a blog post, a good featured image that you're going to use on your blog post or whatever, upload that to Google Plus and use Google's photo editing tools. Make your own little, you know, put your own title on top, or put a little piece of information on, you know, on top of the picture, because you have those, you have that ability. And I mean, heck, there's a couple other, you know, filters and some other treatments that you can add within Google Plus itself, so that the picture you're creating is a little bit more yours, you know, and you can use that as a photo post that links back to your site. You can you know, you can use that as the, you download it and then use that as the image that you put up on Pinterest. Maybe you're, and I went through this little thing, this little phase, you know, my featured images don't have any text on them on the blog post, because that kind of looks cheesy. But on Pinterest, it might make more sense to put text on top of your photo so people can look at the photo instead of having to read the direct, you know, read the description and say, oh, all right, that's what this is about. So, you know, I use Photoshop, but in some cases it was like way faster just to use Google Plus. And from there, I, you know, took a photo, put some text on top, downloaded it, and then just replaced the image, or just, you know, created a new pin for up on Pinterest, and it kind of crafted it manually, as opposed to using, you know, a button, the Pinterest button on my article itself. Mm-hmm. So don't forget that you have these other tools that within Google Plus itself. And I mean, it's something to just keep in mind. Sometimes you don't have to go to a third party.
I do use PicMonkey for mine. And because I start with my blog post, like where my little home base is, and I think for you it's the same, my blog is my home base for everything else that I do. So when I write my blog post, I think about what images I need. And I haven't really shared all this in a blog post yet, so you're getting it first here. I create an image that goes in. I have a featured image on my blog. My blog template has a really bad pinnable image. It's very small on Pinterest, so I don't want people to pin that. So I create a pinnable image that I put in my blog post that's 600 by 900, and then I reduce it so it's not so huge on the in the blog post. But like for the one I did for this event, I made the image, I put it in the blog post, so when and I put the title on the image, so when people click it to pin it, it has the title of the blog post. Instead of like image 428, I mean, you know, you don't want the pin to say image 428. You want it to say, you know, check out this awesome hangout with, you know, with us. So, and then I first put it in the blog post, then I pin it on Pinterest, and I put the URL in there twice. Then I save the pin, then I go post on Google Plus. So I can save I put the big image on there. I can also put the link, and then I can put the pin it for later, which we haven't talked about that yet. But when we post on Google Plus, you can also put the URL and then a pin it for later so people can pin it. There's a little bit of discussion about whether it's not as good to have two links in your Google Plus post, because I think it stops the plus ones from going on your blog. What's your theory on that?
I think you're right. So if you did a photo post and said, you know, check out the link here and then pin it for later, you know, the photo post gets a lot more attention. The click-throughs, I don't tend to do this, so I don't track the click-throughs. I know a couple people who could, you know, maybe weigh in a little later. About the actual, you know, click activity on a link that you share versus a photo with the link in the description. But right. Yeah, when you do it with only one link in there, that link will actually get all the plus ones, and all it's good for really is a social proof. You actually go to the blog post, and you know, let's say you're a guy like Dustin Stout who puts these amazing photos together. I mean, he's amazing with his graphics, and that's how he shares. He'll share just a stellar photo and then link to, you know, with an amazing introduction and link to his blog post. And he gets a tremendous amount of engagement. So for a guy who benefits from that type because of his, you know, his skills and how he crafts everything, for a guy who can benefit from that on Google Plus, you know, he wasn't benefiting from the social proof, right? You're going to go to this blog post, you're going to see maybe a half a dozen plus ones that came from elsewhere on the web,
right?
Where in reality, the thing, what's hot, has like, you know, collective, you know, 2,000 plus ones and shares and comments. And that doesn't tell anybody who's coming to the website, you know, how popular and effective this, you know, blog post was about.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I mean, you do lose that when you do it that way.
But then you gain Pinterest traffic.
But you gain Pinterest traffic, right? And
because when I put the pin it for later, I get tons of repins on those immediately. And to me, I don't know. I'm thinking the pin it for later is a really good bet if you have good Pinterest going already. Because if I forget to put the pin it for later, I have people that say, Peggy, where's my pin? Like they want it on there. They're used to me doing it. And they just, you know, pin it. They do pin it for later. This one was a perfect pin for later because it was just a framing post. And then later, the video is going to be there. So then if you miss it, you have it and you know where it is. That's the beauty of that.
Exactly. And I will say now, if you share the link, you know, which I know most people would prefer to share a big colorful photo that gets a lot of attention, but if you share the link is getting all of your activity on that post is getting all the plus ones, and you're getting all that social proof. You're also getting any, you know, drips of SEO juice that comes along with it. But for the most part, we're talking about traffic, we're talking about that kind of thing. So the goal, if you do share the link and you put the pin it for later URL in your description, you haven't cannibalized anything. So that's another thought.
I just I tried. I cannot just share the link. It's just I can't do it. I always have to do an image. My posts just always do better with an image. I've tried it the other way because there was a little brief period where they were like, don't share the photo at all. And I was like, every time I was going to post, I was like, I need the picture. I'm like trained, you know? So I don't know. I think you make a choice in everything you do. Maybe you sacrifice a little bit here for a little bit something there. So maybe it's, you know, really what works best for you. But I have to say my blog traffic has like exploded since I changed and added both on there. It has not affected my traffic negatively at all. And it's also helped other people that are doing the same thing. Rebecca also does, she does my, you know, she does the link and the pin it for later in her blog has also exploded and her Pinterest. So I just, I don't know. I think it's the, you make your choices. You know, I don't do a lot of SEO stuff. I really just focus on like writing content that I think is interesting, that I hope other people think is interesting as well. And I don't know. So yes, maybe you could get more something this way, but so far this formula is working for me, so I'm sticking with it.
Well, and that's I think a really important piece, you know, takeaway here. And even though it's not specific to Pinterest and Google Plus, but I mean any type of post that you create has to have a strategy, and you have to really know what you want out of it. Otherwise, you're really putting noise out there. You don't know what you're trying to accomplish, and you can't tell whether or not it was effective. I mean, right. Like case in point, you could have put something out that got 100 plus ones and 50 reshares, and at the end of the day, that wasn't what it didn't benefit you the way you needed it to benefit you, because maybe maybe there was something that about that the article you were linking to that that you're missing out on. I don't know, maybe it's like a sign-up or a webinar, I don't know. But every type of post has its own strategy, and you got to think that through. And you know, it's great to have all these ideas in our tool belts, and you just kind of pick the right tools for the job, just like you would for anything else. Mm-hmm. So let's touch on, because we're talking about the pin it for later and things like that, let's touch on the hashtag, because mm-hmm. pin of the day hashtag seems to be... Yeah, you clued me into this one.
I actually made that up.
That did was you me. Really?
Yeah, my friend Kelly Lieberman has Pin Chat on Pinterest, and she is the smartest person on Pinterest that I know. She's amazing on Pinterest. She knows everything. So Kelly, you know I learned everything from you. I really did. She's the smartest. So she isn't on Google Plus, and I keep everybody who I love, I try to convince them over and over again to come to Google Plus if they're not there, and there's a lot of people that I have pulled over. Kelly is one of them. I'm like, Kelly, you have to come over on Google Plus. Just do like a pin of the day. It was literally like that kind of conversation. Just like do a hashtag, pin of the day, share one of your favorite pins, and you know, it gives you something to post every day that's not, you know, if you're on Pinterest, you find at least one pin you love a day. It's just a fact. You do. So Kelly and I started both doing it, and then a whole bunch of other people started doing it. It's actually, like, trended on Pinterest, on Google+. It's been on the trending pins.
Wow.
And big brands use it now. If you click on Twitter, there's a huge stream of pin of the day. If you click on Facebook, pin of the day. It went all over the place. I was like, wow. So anyway, it was a little idea I had that's all over the place now. And basically, the power of a hashtag is it connects your content with other people's content. So I may not have a lot of time today on Google+, but if I want to connect with my friends quickly, I can click on pin of the day and see what they pinned. And I can guarantee that, you know, Holly Homer and Megan Sierkowski pinned something awesome on their pin of the day because they use it. Melissa Taylor uses it. There's tons of like really awesome pinners on Google+. Some of them are established on Google+. Some of them are newer on Google+. So it's actually bringing more pinners over that are like really awesome bloggers that have a lot of skills. So it's kind of mixing groups of like Google+ guys, like if let's totally be stereotypical, because Google+ was all guys for a long time. Pinterest was supposedly all girls, and I'm like both. I'm like, let's all do it together. So I like try to mix the groups together, and it really has worked. You know, I posted a pin of the day last night late, and it was like Chex Mix, like apple cinnamon muddy buddy Chex Mix. I think more guys like that than girls. It was a pin. It was food. You know,
yeah.
it was. It was just, you know, a last little pin for the day.
No, so it's cool.
It's an easy way to share content. It's easy content to share.
Well, and I think another important thing is it's a popular hashtag. So mm-hmm. for those of us trying to find, like that embedded post one I talked about earlier, I'm not one to normally use hashtags. It's just because I would want to use the right ones, and they take too long sometimes. So to go
they
in and search.
They take 2 seconds. All right, that's what we're working on next is hashtags.
Yeah, yeah.
I want three on every post. I'm checking your stuff now. You think I'm kidding, right? I'm totally not.
No, I know you're not kidding. I know. So I opened up. I'm writing this thing, and you know the challenge with any of these social posts, you don't want to leave the page because God forbid you leave the page, you lose all your work, and you're like, you know, you kick yourself for an hour. So
yeah,
and that's why I don't do the hashtags because it's like, oh, God, I'm in the middle of this. Do I really want to go through that? But for this one, you know, I had a strategy.
3 seconds at the bottom. If it's your big post for the day, it's definitely your pin of the day.
Well, that's an important thing. If you know, if you're just putting a couple things out there. Maybe not that big of a deal, but if you have a post that is important or that you have a strategy for, you want to try and drive traffic for a link or for something specific, then yeah, you know, find those hashtags, but find the good ones. Like the embedded posts one I did, I wanted to make sure, and Google Plus is annoying about this because like Google Plus, the hashtag with the plus symbol doesn't really work. You know, you have to use Google Plus. Spelled out, and then there's also G plus because Google Plus is a lot to write out. So you know, it has its own hashtag identity crisis. You know, how do you reference Google Plus and all the different features of it? So for the embedded posting, I just opened up a new window and you know went onto the homepage and looked for the trending hashtags and realized how they said embedded post because I knew it was going to be trending. So I'm like, all right, embedded post, boom, here we go. So that was but it's important to find. What people and so the one thing you can do just to get total sidebar for the hashtags. The one thing I do know is that people who know what they're doing on these networks know which hashtags to use. So you could always just go look up a Peg Fitzpatrick and see what types of hashtags she's using, or you know, like a Ronnie Bincer for Hangouts related stuff, and look you know for what hashtags he's using, just because they know the right ones that are that. Get trending and things like that. So,
well, I think you touched on part of it. There's always, always daily hashtags trending on Google Plus. So that's one place to start. If you don't know what you want to share right then, if you're looking for something that you want to do a post about, check the trends to use it. That's one way. Another way is to and make sure that your hashtags are always relevant because nothing makes people more angry than using a hashtag that's not related to your post. If you post, you know, a Google Plus tip and put, you know, like a Caturday hashtag on there, the Caturday people are going to be pissed because they don't want, you know, they're supposed to be relevant content, you know, and that's kind of like a you know, self-monitored or community-monitored. If you abuse it, those Google Plus people will be more than happy to tell you to get off to change it. But yeah, use relevant hashtags. I usually try for like 3. I do like 3, and I just put them at the bottom. And I do think that it helps connect with other people and have people find your content. So I do think they're important.
So I got
on Twitter and Twitter. I just use 1. Facebook, I'm not convinced that. Even though you can use them there, I don't like them there. So
yeah, it's there's too many. The post has to be there's too many privacy layers on top of it. But
yeah.
So I do have a question for you because when we're talking about the pin of the day and that kind of, and you know editing our pins to kind of create the right URL and things. So what are your thoughts on bringing Pinterest traffic back to Google Plus posts versus maybe your website? Like what are some strategies or reasons or you know why you would do one or the other? It's like I mean it's one thing you could post you could do your picture on Google, like your photo post on Google Plus and put the article link and then put the pin it link. Well, you can have that Pinterest link come back to the page, you know, come back to your Google Plus post, or you could actually have it go over to you know your blog article. Like what do you think?
I always make everything go back to my blog. So when I do my pins and I do pin it for later, the pin it for later is to Pinterest, but the Pinterest pin leads to my blog. I do pin things from Google Plus. If they are just Google Plus posts, then I will link it back there, because there's a lot of people who don't have blogs but write amazing content. and I will add an image. One of the things that Google Plus, you can post without an image. Pinterest, you have to have an image. So sometimes I will find an image to post something that I really love from Google Plus. but yeah, everything to me is always leading back to my blog traffic. But the Pin It For Later ultimately does lead back to my blog. So even though that I put a link to my blog and I put a link to Pinterest for Pin It For Later, that does have a link to my blog. So I feel like it's ultimately all going back there.
Yeah, you're creating
a little circle. You can look at it here, you can look at it here, or you can read the whole thing.
Right. Well, yeah, you create a loop for yourself. What I've been trying to do in some cases is provide the actual, like, I'll pin it first, and then I'll say, oh, if you're interested in this, here's the link to pin, you know, to pin it, because then I can kind of control. I mean, not that everybody would follow my lead here, but that people might say, oh, well, he already has the pin, let me repin it. So then you get a little bit of the repin flow and, definitely, you know, things, because I know you can trace these things back if you work hard enough to try and get back to the original sources and all. It kind of helps create that trail, you know, kind of like we have with Google Plus Ripples, to see, you know, how a pin is traveling. So if you've already pinned it, it's like having Pin It For Later on your Google Plus post. Well, actually doing it on your blog post too. Like, hey, I already did it for you. Use this link instead of the actual, you know, article.
Right. And then the beauty of, you know, Ripples, if you add your Pinterest link in there, it goes to all those Google Plus people, so they get your blog link and your Pinterest link.
Right.
So I'm sticking with that for now. I think it's definitely working for me, and it's worked for other people boosting their web traffic and their Pinterest traffic. And as I mentioned before, Pinterest has the longest life. So if you sort your things on relevant boards, like you sort your Pinterest things together, your Google Plus tips together, I have one that's just like overall social media. And another tip is you can pin things, the same thing, on more than one board. So if you pin I post my blog post on Monday, and I pin it on, depending on what it is, it might go on my Blogtastic board or my Positively Peggy board. Or then later in the week, I can move it to a different, you know, pin it on another one. You don't want to pin the same pin to like three boards at the same time, because that's like spammy in people's Pinterest stream. But a day later, 2 days later, repin your same blog post to another board. So you're sharing your own content, because maybe people only follow your Google Plus board. Maybe they don't also follow your blogging board.
Right.
So it's perfectly okay to put it on more than one. Just don't do it all at the same time.
Another thing that I've started to do, because, I mean, I'm just starting to pick up, you know, a little bit of momentum, I guess you could say, with Pinterest, is when I'm on Google Plus and I'm posting, I'm actually not using Pin It For Later. I'm using Pin To My Google Plus Tips and Techniques board. So it kind of calls out.
It's a call to action. It's a good call to action. Yep.
It's like, here's what this whole board is about. If this floats your boat, you know, there's more goodies where this came from, basically, not just this one specific bookmarking call to action, which is really all it is. So it's almost like a second call to action to say, hey, you know, there's more where this came from. You know, another thing too that we should probably point out, you know, we talked about trying to funnel all traffic back to the blogs, but even if you don't have a blog, you can pin, because you can pin back to Google Plus posts or communities. I mean, everything on Google Plus has its own URL. It's its own static web page. So the fact is, if you have a community, if you have a couple of like maybe resource recap posts that you've created that just you did it specifically for Google Plus, or maybe a shared circle. Some of the things that are native to the platform like a shared circle would be a great example for Pinterest. You could create your shared circle of, let's say, you know, amazing bloggers who are on Google Plus, and share that, and then, you know, take a screen capture of that, or maybe just create your own cool graphic for it, put it up on Pinterest, and take people back to that post, which has the shared circle. Now, from there, somebody coming from Pinterest over to the shared circle has a great way to add people that they might find very interesting right up front to their, you know, to their circles and to start following it, and you kind of already have a connection because you know who, what they're about, and you sort of found them from a common medium. Mm-hmm. And the same thing I think with, I would say with communities too. So if you have a community, you know, that, that exists on Google Plus, to create a cool graphic for it, the badges that we have are they're square. But
no, they're actually rectangle, aren't they?
No, they get cropped.
Okay.
They are square. If you look at the if you scroll down past
you're right. Yeah, I was thinking
the suggested ones, it's a big square. So I would recommend anybody creating a graphic for their community, start with a really large picture, and it'll just get, you know, it'll just shrink down. And then from there, you know, maybe add some text over top of it or something like that, because remember, you're going to put this badge on Pinterest, and people aren't really going to know what it is. So create a little bit of a graphic for yourself. Use Google Plus's photo editing tools. Take that graphic, put it up onto your Pinterest board, and then change the link back over to your community, so that people, you know, you're just basically saying you did it for the Close the Gap, Close the Google Plus Gap one that we're on together, that you and Rebecca set up. You know, that community now is being promoted on a post on a board about Google Plus. So it's like, oh wow, I'm interested in Google Plus. Here's a community that can kind of help, you know, introduce me gently and close that gap. Let me go check this out. It's an ad banner.
There's tons of stuff that you could pin on that board too. You could pin people that are in the community. You could go on Pinstamatic and make a little like profile pin for each person. You could do that just for the moderators. You could add great posts from the community. I mean, if your community is posting stuff, that's, you know, you can pin all those things and lead them either to that article or back to your community. There's a lot of ways that you can tie them together. And it just introduces, you know, people to either Pinterest or Google Plus. You know, either way that they, you know, either way the traffic's going, that's how they really work well together. They really do just like tie together. And then when you start thinking, I also do the thing where I'll share from the board too. Like sometimes if I'm just doing a pin, I have a travel bug board that I like to post either. Yeah, that's the one where I post places that I just have been. So I'll put a pin, and I'll, you know, put that pin, and then I'll put more on my travel bug board. So you can share your whole board, you can share an individual pin, or your whole profile. You know, there's nothing wrong with saying, hey, I'm on Pinterest, you know, like just one. You never know if people click on other stuff in your profile. So just share your profile and say, hey, these are my three favorite pinners. Who are your three favorite pinners? List them underneath on Google Plus. Right. And then Google Plus people can meet some new pinners.
Yeah, totally. I mean, it's, you know, Pinterest, from what I've learned, is really a great curation platform, right? And so, and Google Plus kind of brings the interactivity to it. But, I mean, in the same, but it also has a lot of curation tools. So between communities and shared circles and even different, you know, curation pages. I'm kind of into that a little bit, but I mean, there are a lot of ways to help organize content and curate it in a way that if you start putting the two of them together, it just becomes a really good, you know, synergistic.
It's like peanut butter and jelly, right?
It's peanut butter and jelly, Peg.
They stick together and they're so good. And you know what? Only one person asked me which one's peanut butter and which one's jelly, and that was my daughter. I say. Google Plus is the peanut butter because it's like got the protein and the you know, it's like better for your diet. Well, it's, you know, if you have too much of it, it's not good for you. And Pinterest is more like the jelly, the sweet little, you know, layer. So
I love it. I would have flipped it. I actually would have said that because of things, I would have gone with the sticky angle. That, you know,
really?
Peanut butter is more sticky. So and Pinterest has the long lifespan and all that other stuff. But hey, that's funny that kids come up with those kinds of things. My girls would have said that, probably brought that up as well. So, all right, you know what? We're kind of at a good spot here. I think, is there anybody you want to give a shout out to, or maybe recommend some boards to come check out or run?
Well, I would definitely say Kelly Lieberman is amazing on Pinterest. She has a pin chat every Wednesday at, I believe, 9 o'clock, and it's hashtag pin chat. As Cynthia Sanchez, also Pinteresting, has an amazing podcast, which you should definitely check her out and listen to her. gosh, there's so many awesome pinners. Holly Homer is huge on Google+. She's amazing on Pinterest, and it's not her favorite, but darn it, she's so good on there. And Megan Schakowsky also is really awesome on Google+ and Pinterest. I love people that are doing both, you know. And Rebecca Radis also is, you know, she's really, she focuses on a lot of the same things I do, social media marketing, and but we both use both of them.
Cool. So if any of you are, the four of you are listening and you would like to come over and maybe say hi on one of the, whether it's the event page or whatever, drop your board link in here on in a comment so that other people who are checking this out can, you know, can come follow you, whether it's on Google+ or Pinterest or on both. That
or
would
both.
Be really
yeah.
awesome.
Yeah.
Right? I guess I hope everybody got some good tidbits and ideas out of here. I know we kind of went in a bunch of different circles, but hopefully that's what's going to happen, right? The whole idea was to put the two of them together and mash them up like peanut butter and jelly, and I think we did a good job with that. So hopefully if anybody has any questions, you can leave comments on YouTube, you can leave comments, you know, shout out to either Peg or I on Google+.
Yeah.
We both have these, I think we're both going to have these videos embedded on our own web pages, so you can comment there as well. And I want to thank everybody. Join me next time for another chat about things that will make you have a better, smarter web presence. That's all. So have a great day, everyone.